And if anyone wants to, okay, my volume on my laptop's really loud. if anyone wants to catch up or watch this lecture later, I will export my R history after this, because you can, if you want useful things, you can look here and see the history of all the things you've been typing. Ignore all the stuff here. It's a spoiler for the end of the lecture. I was making sure things worked earlier. But I'll export that and make a big text file and everyone can download it. So you don't have to worry about writing down all the notes that are in my console here. I'll basically just share the entire history of my console with everyone as well. So we can subset our vector. We could, for example, make a variable called v underscore one, and we use our assignment operator and do v and square bracket one again. And then that, what that does is that puts that first value of this vector into v underscore one. So that now has the value of four. You can also take larger subsets of your vector, not just, for example, the individual values. And to do that, we use the same notation where we type the name of our vector and square brackets. And then let's say to get the first three elements of our vector, we would type one because we're starting with the first element, then a colon character, and then three. So what this is telling us to say is say select from V elements one through and including three. So when we hit enter on that, it's going to give us a new vector with this these three elements in it. What's also cool about R is you can do certain operations on vectors the same way that they would be applied to individual numeric number data types. So for example, where we did X plus five above and got 10, you could do V plus five and it adds five to each one of these individual numbers in the list. So this becomes really helpful when you're trying to sort of transform large arrays or make sure there aren't zeros in your data. You can just do X plus one and it'll add you know, a value to all of the data and things like that. So this is how you kind of do basic numerical operations in R, how you'd interact with the console. But and they kind of showed a more sort of intricate version where you have these actual notebooks where you do markdown and things like that with your code, which is really cool. But another sort of basic way of saving code so you can reuse it later is by just using a more basic R script. So the way that we can access an R script is we go up to file, new file, and then select R script, or you can do command or control shift and N. And when you do that, I know when I share screen, my mouse kind of goes off the screen when I do that, when I select the new thing. So if you weren't able to find that, let me know. But what you should see is a new window appears here in your RStudio where you actually have a text file to edit. Sometimes when you do that, it pushes your console all the way down like this, so you can't see it, but all you have to do is just go down here and grab it and kind of pull it back up. So you can resize all of these windows. You can, you know, shift this over, whatever is sort of comfortable for you. Whatever makes things easiest to see. So you can see we've still got our console down here, and now we've got our new R script up here. And what we can do is we can type, well, first we can, obviously we can save our script. So what you wanna do is first, when you're interacting with R has this notion similar to Python, if you've used that before, of a working directory. And the working directory is just wherever R sort of considers its home or its kind of base. So set your working directory is you go to some folder on your laptop, and then you go over to this more, this like cog icon here, and you can go click set as working directory. And this kind of sets it your sort of base wherever R first looks for files that you interact with as this particular directory that you're in. You can also, if you're not sure where your working directory actually is, you can type this command git wd followed by an open parentheses, which are then, you know, autocomplete to the close, and hit enter. And it prints out a full path of where your current working directory is. What we can do is, now that we have this new script, we can save it with Command or Control S. And I'm going to call this script, vector addition example.r. I'll go ahead and save that. And you can see it now appears in our list of files where I put it in my working directory. And I can type in the script some of the commands that we used earlier. So for example, on the first line, we can say x is 5. We can say our vector is this vector from before. We can do this v plus 5 is the name of a vector, and we'll say it's equal to the value of v plus 5. And then we can have another line of code that actually prints out that result. So we can type print and then v plus 5. So this is print is a built-in function in R that will take whatever it's given and put some textual representation of it on your console down here. So that's an important sort of function to remember among a number of others we're going to talk about, is this print function. And you can then save your script. And to demonstrate how to run a script and kind of what it would do, I'm going to go over to this broom thing here, which is kind of useful if you're doing a lot of work in R and you're saving a whole bunch of variables and you just wind up with a whole ton of stuff in this tab over here and you just kind of want to refresh and start over. You can click on this broom, and that'll give you the option to clear objects from your workspace. Go ahead and click yes. And see, now it resets and gets rid of all the data. It's also helpful if you're using too much memory and you want to get rid of some larger objects. And then what we can do is we can go ahead and put our cursor back over on our R script, which has these four lines of code. And then we can type command or control, depending on whether you're on Mac or Windows, shift key, and then the enter key. And what that did is it automatically stepped through each of these lines of code, basically automatically put them in the console here, and it populated our results over in this environment tab. So if you want to save an analysis that you've been doing with your data, you can write all the code into a script, and sort of similar in the way that knit operation worked, but in kind of a little more less fancy way. You can run all the code in your R script by doing run or by doing this command shift enter to run the entire script here as well. And then of course we get this red star here. It means you've made changes to your file. So that's important to remember in case, because you never want to lose the progress that you're working on. So I always, whenever you're writing code, I always recommend saving really frequently, because it's really easy to make a lot of progress and then just kind of something crashes, or you accidentally write an infinite loop of code that crashes your whole laptop. It happens from time to time, and you lose your data. So just like you are with you're writing a document in Microsoft Word or something, I'd always save relatively frequently. So we've been doing this sort of operation here where we add values to things and such, and this is very what programmers often refer to it as hard coded, which means you've got these values like 5 and 4, 3, 2, 1 and all these things really baked into your code and you can't change them. So if you wanted to someday have code that adds some other number to some other vector, you would have to go in and edit the script. So instead, what we'd like to do is we'd like to define functions which allow us to take analyses like that and make them more general so you can apply them to lots of different kinds of data. So in our case, we're going to write a function that we're going to call add to vector. And we'll use our assignment operator again, because a function like data is just, another variable that has some value. In this case, that variable happens to contain a function. And then we type the word function. You'll see it kind of highlights blue because it's sort of a fancy keyword in the R language. And then we're going to type in open parentheses, and then we'll put a letter V here and in here, close the parentheses, and then type an open bracket, curly bracket, and then hit enter. So you kind of get your cursor here and it pushes this bracket down here. So this is the syntax, the basic syntax for defining a function. And you can read this sort of in English as saying add to vector is a function of the inputs v and n, where we're going to say v is our vector and n is the value, that that scalar value that we were adding to our vector. And we're just going to have a very simple function. It's just going to be one line of code. And it is going to be, we first type the word return, which is another kind of fancy keyword in R that highlights in blue syntax here. And we just type v plus n. And the way that we would be able to then use this function in our code is we could do that command shift enter again, or control shift enter. And you'll notice we now have a tab here called functions with this add to vector. But another way that you can load a, say you add a file with several, 10 or 20 functions in it, and you want to just load them all without having to actually open the file and type command shift enter, I'm going to go ahead and clear my workspace again. What you could do instead is go to your console, type the word source with an open parentheses, then quotation marks, and the name of the file. You'll notice I was able to type that really quickly because there's a nice feature in R called tab completion, which is where if you start typing the name of a file, and since there are no other file names like it, you can hit the tab key. So all you have to do is type, in this case, we have no other files that start with V. So you can just type V and hit tab. And well, in this case, there's another function called vapply. So if you type VE and hit tab, it will give you that whole string there. So it's a nice way of typing, really long strings or file names or paths in case you have to do that at some point. And if we now hit enter, you'll notice again, it populates this function, this add to vector function here. And so now what we can do is use that function in our command line. So let's redefine that vector that we had before in the same way with that C function, that C sort of syntax. And we'll say I don't want to do it that way. I'm going to make an important point. So I'm just going to go ahead and clear this data again. And I advise you to do that as well. Hit command enter, and this adds a vector. And what we're going to do is, instead of writing that V and N, because I want to show an important point in a second, we're going to type add to vector. And you can see that it's now autocompletes here, just like all these other built-in functions, because it's an additional function that we've added to R and put in our environment. So you can go ahead and click on that. And where it says V, let's go ahead and type that vector in. You don't have to have it assigned to a variable. You can just kind of type it in. And where it says in, let's put our 5 and hit enter. And you can see that it gave us this 9876. You can also make a variable called like result or something and say add to vector with that same vector that we had before, that same scalar value. You can see res is now equal to that, that result. And that's what this return keyword does, because you could have any other code and different operations happening in the function, but the return is what is the value you give back to the user when they use your function. And when we have return v plus n, that's why we get that the result of v plus n put in this result that we put here. And the important point I said I was going to make when I was accidentally typing in variable names earlier is that you'll notice that this V and N are not in our environment, even though we were operating on them within the confines of this function. And that brings to light a really important concept in programming languages in general called scope, which is sort of the range of your whole programming environment where variables have meaning. And in R, when you have these variable names here, which are actually just parameters, they're not really variables in your environment. They exist while this function code is running. And when the function execution ends, those variables no longer exist. So you could, you know, define variables and parameters inside here that then no longer have context sort of outside of that function. It'd be these parameter names do not get saved as variables. So you can reuse them and say, well, let's say our result instead is, you know, some other totally different input to our function where this result has changed here. But again, this V and N are not in our environment. They only have meaning inside of that function. They just have their sort of placeholders for service for the input for the parameters. So let's see, what are we going to do next? And then I already showed you how you can, you know, source the script. There's also the source button up here does the same thing. As using the source function here. So now we can start to look at some of the other built-in functionality that R has for doing statistics. And R is primarily a language that was sort of invented for use with statistics. So as other languages, you might have to use external packages and things like that. For some basic statistics, R is a lot of stuff that's just built in that you can use right out of the box. So one of those things is, and since there's so many functions, what's also nice is R also has a lot of built-in documentation. So for example, there's a function called mean. And if we wanted to read about the mean function, you could type a question mark in your console followed by the word mean. So that's the name of the function and hit enter. And it's going to bring up a whole bunch of documentation here. And R is kind of a standardized format for the documentation where you get a description of, you know, in a sentence or two, what the function does. You get the actual, what we call the signature of the function, which is its name, including its parameters, where X is, you know, this numerical vector that you put in. And then it gives you a description of what the output value of that input of that function is. So for example, we can type mean of a vector, which again, we define with that C parentheses syntax. You know, then we're gonna use the same one as before. And obviously that gives us 2.5. There's also a standard deviation function, which is just SD. And we can do that again with this same syntax, gives you the standard deviation of a vector. So you can use these, you know, as soon as you start looking at data in R, you can immediately look at, okay, what's the mean of my data? What's this, you know, variance of my data? What's the standard deviation of my data? And R lets you just do all those things just immediately right away while you're interacting with it. It also has nice utility functions for sampling from statistical distributions. Like for example, you can sample a whole bunch of random numbers related to the normal distribution or the bell curve as people sometimes call it. And we can get those as a vector. So the way you do that is we'll make a variable called vals1, which I'll use these in some examples later on. We'll put our assignment operator again. And then we type the name of the function, which is rnorm or sort of random normal distribution. So rn or rm. Where we're going to have n is equal to 100. We're going to have 100 observations where our mean is going to be 50 and the standard deviation of our observations is going to be 10. And so you could hit enter. And you'll see that we now have a whole bunch of random numbers in this vals1 vector. If we do the same thing, we'll say vals2 is equal to our norm, where we again ask for 100 random observations with a mean of 50 and a standard deviation of 10. It's gonna give us a whole set of completely different random numbers. And you can also use, as Zaid was showing you, you can use some built-in functions to plot your data. So we can do a histogram of just one of these where you can do histogram of bells one, and that's going to take you over to your plots tab, where it's showing you that we have an, you know, an approximately normal distribution out of, you know, all of our observations, as we would expect, because this R norm is a function to essentially simulate a null distribution. You can also use, for the histogram function, you can use the breaks parameter. So you set breaks equals, for example, 15. We now get more bins. Well, maybe it already had 15. I don't know. Try 20. Yeah, so you now get more bins, or you can even have, you know, fewer bins in your histogram, which is, you know, the most common variable that people want to change, or parameter that people want to change when they're making histograms. So in a lot of other languages, it's called bins, but in R, it's called breaks. And you'll notice we have this plot tab that has a lot of functionality. And one of the things you can do here is you can export it. So you can either copy to your clipboard, and it opens this window where you can copy this image and paste it into a PowerPoint or something. Or you can also save the image, and you have a variety of file formats to save that as. It populates here with what your current working directory is, but you can go ahead and save that. And we can see we've now got a PNG saved in our folder that you can go access and put in your PowerPoint slides or whatever you want to do with it. We can also plot two-dimensional plots with just the word plot instead of hist. So for example, we could plot vowels one and vowels two, and we can say, well, these are two completely different random variables that we've generated. So if we plot them, they clearly have no relationship to each other, which is good. You could also do something like plot with vowels one and vowels one plus five. And then we would get a nice straight line where you can see here we have our x coordinate is this first thing, and our y coordinate is, you can see it's roughly, you know, whatever the x coordinate is, plus five. So that's our second value here. So it's always plot of whatever you want on x, and then whatever you want on y is how that syntax would work. And of course, you could do the same sort of exporting and saving and copying to clipboard that you could do with the with those other plots. All right, so now we've done some basic plotting, we've done some basic descriptive statistics with mean and standard deviation. So now we can work with one of the example data sets that R had. As I had mentioned, R has some built-in toy examples that people will often use to sort of test their code or demonstrate statistical concepts. This data set that I sent you all is one of them, but I wanted to teach you how to read data in from an external file rather than just sourcing the data, which is why I downloaded it from R and emailed it to everyone. So if you want to go get that file, toothgrowth.csv, wherever you might have saved it on your laptop, you know, you can just set that as the working directory and or move the file into whatever your current working directory is. And I'll give everyone just a second to do that.
Excuse me, where is the file again?
So it was emailed in an email from Elizabeth Santiana. So you can look for her name as well in your emails. And it's called toothgrowth.csv. So if you could let me know when you find it. And then in the meantime, if anyone else has any trouble finding it, let me know.
I just uploaded it to the chat as well, just in case.
Okay, perfect. Romina, were you able to download it from chat or find the email?
I haven't got anything in the chat, and through my emails, like I didn't get like a lot of emails.
Can anyone else see it in the chat?
Yeah, I can see it in the chat.
Okay, let me try one more time then.
You know, I guess make sure you scroll to the bottom. Make sure you're looking at the bottom of the chat. You scroll all the way down.
Mm-hmm. Can you see it there or no?
Not really, no. Okay. I can see Armin saying I can. That's the last thing that I can see.
Oh, but you don't. Oh, weird.
Can you want me to forward you the email?
Yeah, exactly.
Put your email in the put your email in the thing. I'll forward it. Thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
All right, let me know when you've got it downloaded and we'll go ahead.
Okay, I sent it. Is it sent?
Yeah, I forwarded it to your email that you sent in the chat.
Okay. I keep like refreshing it. Let me check my spam maybe.
I shared the Google Sheet with you in case you want to check that.
Okay, there you go, I got it. Thank you, got it.
All right. We're able to download it into the working directory that you're using for R.
Yes, I'm downloading it right now.
Okay, great. So first step that we need to do is we need to actually read this from the comma separated values that it's in right now format, where it's essentially in a table, kind of a spreadsheet format, where each element in the table in the row is separated by a comma. And we can load that format of data into R by, we'll call it, it's just another variable, just another different type of data. And we'll call this variable TG and put the assignment operator again. And then we use a function called read.csv. And I'll also make a note here for people who know how to program in another language. The dot in R is really just another character. It does not imply some kind of membership or like a field or a function of a class or anything like that. It's just a character. So that could be kind of confusing and awkward if you're familiar with like Python, for example. But I just wanted to make that clarifying comment for people who have programmed in other languages before, that the dot has no real significance. So we can type read.csv. We'll put our quotation marks and type the name toothgrowth.csv. And we can hit enter. And you can see here that this has given us a similar data frame as to what was showing earlier. You can click this arrow to see kind of a summary of the data. This is a a data set with three columns or three variables and 60 observations or data points. You can also just go ahead and click on this TG, as I think Lauren mentioned, and then you can see the actual table. You can't actually edit it from this view. You can just look at it, but it basically just kind of a Microsoft Excel style view of the data. And what we can do is, and I think Zaid mentioned this earlier with the dollar syntax, that dollar sign is essentially how you access when it comes to a data frame. That's how you access columns or different variables within that data frame. So to get the column or data, which is len, or I guess length, you would type TG followed by a dollar sign. And you can see already it shows you the three options that you have in terms of columns that are in this data frame. So we can go ahead and select len. It's going to show you the values that we have here. It's the same way that Zaid showed you. You can also subset the data using the actual sort of row numbers or column numbers. And this works really similarly to when we were subsetting values from a vector earlier. And the way you do that is you type TG followed by an open bracket and a closed bracket. And let's say the first thing we want to do is we want to select the first 10 rows and all three columns. So what you always would do in a two-dimensional table like this is you specify the rows you want, a comma, and then the columns you want. And so we want the first 10 rows. What we do is we type 1:10, which means select, get the values 1 up through and including 10. And then we can just type a comma. And because we want all three columns, we don't have to type anything after this comma. So you can just leave it just like that, hit enter, and it gives us a subset of the table with the first 10 rows. A really common mistake is to just forget the comma. And what happens when you do that is R is going to give you this error that says undefined column selected. And when you see undefined column selected or undefined rows selected, you can pretty much just always assume that it's because you've forgotten that comma. That's the first thing to check when you get that error. You can also select just the third column, the dose, by typing 1:10 and then 3, which gives us the first 10 rows of the dose column, which is just this numerical vector of these values. Alternatively, you can get the exact same thing by typing TG, first 10 rows, all columns, and then at the end, you can type dose, selecting it with this dollar sign notation instead of the 3 there. That gives you the exact same result. There are also ways that you can filter the data based not like on the row indexes, but on the actual values of the columns themselves. So the first thing is actually what it looks like when you evaluate true and false expressions on vectors or on data frames in R. So for example, if I just type the phrase TG, we're going to get the length value, and then we put less than 10. So this is just saying, is that TG length value less than 10? If I hit enter, that's going to tell you all the positions, all the rows where that is true, where it's either true or false. So these are Boolean variables in R. And you can use these this true false result of this expression to actually select rows. So if you do TG and then in square brackets and copy that same expression, it's going to give you a subset. Whoops, guess what I forgot? You still got to put that comma there because you're selecting all the rows where this is true and all the columns. And you can see that it's got the column numbers here. So we only selected 1, 3, 4, 10, 34, 40. So we've skipped a whole bunch, but we've only kept the ones where that TG, that length value is less than 10. So you can put Boolean expressions like these instead of the actual assignment. So let's think about how we would actually add data to this table as well. There's a useful function in R called rep, where it takes whatever you give it and repeats it however many times you ask for it. So if we do rep of the number one, or just say one, or just the word hi, for example, in quotations, and put 49 as the number of times to repeat it, it will give you back a vector with that value repeated 49 times. So let's say, for example, that these are like, I don't know, these are mice or something in a study that this data is from. I don't actually know what this is from. It's like from rabbits or something. And let's say that we know the first 30 are male mice and the last 30 are female mice. And we want to add that into our data. So what we can do is we can say, let's build a vector. We'll just call it sex. And we'll say we put that C to make a vector, and we can repeat M 30 times. And then we can also repeat F 30 times. So I'll give us a little bit of a complicated expression. So I'll give everyone a chance to copy that down. And then I'll go ahead and hit enter. If we look at it, it's now got this MMMMM for 30 times and then F for 30 times. So that's a nice kind of useful thing about this C syntax, is you can combine a whole bunch of things that are more complicated than, you know, just one value into a vector. And then to actually add that to our data, we type TG, and we're going to call the column the sex of the animal, and we'll use our assignment operator and then assign it like that. And you can see now, if we look at the table up in the environment tab, we can see that this is now a fourth variable that's been added. So now we have the biological sex of our animals in our study, or whatever this happens to represent in this data. So now we can go into kind of some basic analysis on the data. And usually the first thing you want to do is do some kind of basic visualization to see if you have any outliers or kind of what the mean and deviation and variance of your data is. So we went over hist and plot earlier, but there's also box plot, where we can say we want to look at the distribution of the length variable in our data. So here we would type TG $win inside of our box plot function, hit enter, and we see that it's given, you know, it's given us a nice little plot over here showing us what the kind of quartiles are. I think by default does 25th percentile, 75th percentile up here, and puts the median there. So that's a nice way of kind of visualizing the data and kind of seeing if there are any major outliers. But we want to plot this data sort of as a function of our categorical variables, which are the supplement and dose. And so we can do that by, again, going for our box plot function and typing that length variable in. But now what we can do is add this tilde, or this sort of this squiggly character. And what that means is, it's a way of writing an expression in R that means as a function of. So we're telling boxplot to plot our data as a function of, for example, the supplement, or I assume that stands for supplement. And if we enter on that, we can see that it's now on our x-axis, because we're looking at the data as a function of that variable. Let's put that variable on the x-axis, and it split our data into two boxes. So now we're not just representing the overall distribution of the length values, we're looking at the distribution of those values as a function of those two different categorical, that categorical variable, this VC and OJ that we have in our data. And we can do the same thing as well with the other variable, which is dose. And, you know, we look at this and say like, oh, that's interesting that this dose variable, you know, has a large relationship, it looks like, you know, just visually with the actual length, our response response variable. So now we can actually start to do some basic statistical analysis of our data. And one of those questions that you can ask is, for example, like, is there a statistically significant difference between the lengths for those two different supplement categories, VC and OJ? And if we just assume that our data is normally distributed, we can use a function called t.test in R, which if any of you have had statistics before, this essentially just implements a basic t-test, which we will give it two different values or an expression to evaluate. And what we're asking is, are the means of this data more different than you would expect if the data was just totally randomly generated, or if the data came from really this both the same underlying distributions, if the VC and OJ distinction didn't matter at all? So what we can do is we can type t.test, again, looking at the length as a function of the supplement. So this is saying, for the values in our supplement, is there any statistical difference between them when we look at this length? If we enter, the first, it's going to give you a whole summary of the statistical test that it ran. And there's a lot that could go into here. That could be a whole couple of statistics lectures. But one thing you can kind of zero in on is this p-value, which tells you essentially what I was describing before is let's assume for a minute that all of this data in our length column is just randomly generated with no reliance on any kind of real world conditions at all, or two separate, you know, conditions. And what is the probability that, you know, you would get the mean that the VC values have and the mean that the OJ values have? What is the probability that they're as different as they are if this data was randomly generated? And that probability here is saying is 6%. So usually people use kind of 0.05, depending on the application. Again, heavily depending on the application and the type of statistical test that you're doing. So we could say, well, maybe this is borderline, but there's not a super strong relationship there in terms of a difference.
Alex, do you mind if I ask you a question?
Yeah, of course.
This is a bit further back, but when you were doing the box plot, mm-hmm. when you were doing the box plot of len and sup, for some reason, I wasn't able to get the same plot that you had. And when I looked back at my data set, it looks like both of those variables for me are continuous variables. So I'm not sure. I went ahead and like uploaded the data set again. I did that command that we have of view TG. And when I do that, I think for you, your sup is either OJ or VC, but mm-hmm. for me, that's coming up as dose. My sup, like my, I have values that have a decimal point to them. I don't know if anyone else is experiencing that. If it's just me, I can re-download the data set.
Yeah, it could be that, so when R saves data, it does put row numbers in. So it could be that all your column names got shifted over somehow. Did you just use read.csv to read them in the way that I did?
So I actually didn't label my working directory. I gave it the file name and the location of the file, like when I wrote it in.
But you still use this same function, read.csv?
Double check, yes. Read.csv and then open parentheses file equals, and I told it exactly where it was on my computer.
Okay.
I'll look into it, no problem. Obviously for me then, like the t-test wasn't working because I didn't have the right type of variables, but okay, thanks.
Yeah, I'm not sure why, what version of R do you have? Maybe older versions of R, don't assume row numbers by default, because that's what sounds like happened. It sounds like everything got shifted over in yours.
Yeah, and I think, oh, that's interesting. When I downloaded mine, my dose, the downloaded file that I'm just looking at on my computer, my dose is like the VC OJ stuff. And I think that's what's supposed to be the sup variable.
Is the len just like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5?
Yes.
Yeah, So that's exactly what happened. And I'm not sure why that's happening for you, because R usually assumes that the row names are, I think it asks for them by default is null, and it assumes the row names are numbered there, because it's what's happening is, if we look at the raw file, I think what you could do to fix it is,
I just tried downloading the one that had been uploaded into the chat. So we'll see if that one, I can read that one in.
Yeah, I think if you set row names to be.
Okay, I don't want to take up too much more time of this class. I will sort it out. Thank you.
Yeah, just try setting row names equals null in the thing. So if you do read.csv, we've got a lot of extra time, so that's okay. Don't worry about it. And then I think if you do row.name, does that still load right for me? No, it doesn't. It that is not what I was expecting at all. If I just do true.
What about the header? Sometimes.
No, just header is just if the first column is headers. Yeah.
The other thing you could do is just open it up in a text editor and put a comma in the front and see if that fixes it for your machine.
Oh, that might. Yeah, that might. So you could take it and open the file and then just right here, put a comma. Like that. Try that.
Okay. Yeah, I manually messed with the data file saved on my computer, and we're good to go. Thank you.
Oh, great. Okay. Yeah. Sometimes weird, depending on operating system, depending on version of R, weird things like that can happen. So you'll often find this is kind of a part of data science and biomedical informatics, is just fixing errors like this of parsing the data, reading the data, sharing the data with other people who might have different operating systems or different versions of languages and things like that. It's always good to, you know, take a look at the documentation of the function that you're using to load the data. Make sure that you look at the first couple lines of data, for example, to make sure that it's matching kind of the assumptions that you have about it. Glad we got that figured out. So the last thing we did was that at t-test, see that there's not necessarily there's a somewhat of a association between the supplement, I think it was, the dose, sorry, and or the supplement, yeah, and the link. You can also do, we can also say, is there a correlation, for example, between this dose and the length? And the way that you could do that is by typing core.test with the length as the first input and the dose as the second input. And what that's doing is just standard Pearson correlation test. And this time we see the p-value